talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy my
Again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Our Savior Christ Jesus abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell.
Because I live, you will live also. Death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away.
Let us continue as we sing our opening hymn. Father of an everlasting grace, come Christians, join to sing. Hallelujah.
Christians, join to sing, hallelujah.
Jesus, please remain standing. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. As we continue in this act of celebration, we continue with the hymn, Father of Everlasting Grace. Gracious God, we turn to you in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you. And may our hearts be so composed to the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit minister to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life, Lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Sisters and brothers, friends, family, and we also acknowledge those of us gathered online as we share together this moment. We are met to commend in this solemn moment Wendy Pamela Litchmore into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. We gather to celebrate the life of one whom we have met and interfaced with and have found sweet communion. And as we do so, we will be comforted by Scripture. We will hear words of memorial in her honor. But we also will draw from this hope because our sister died living in God. And so the hope of those who die like that, as Jesus said, will live again. As we continue to mourn, and particularly for you, Reverend Barrington Litchmore, and other members of the family, we pray that you'll draw comfort and strength in what will happen here. And may God help you to live through the days ahead of you all. As we continue, we would just like to mention at this time that many of our ministers would have wanted to be here, but for one reason or the other, they could not. But specifically, the Reverend Dr. Philip Robinson has asked to be mentioned, as this morning he has a funeral in St. Thomas and celebrating the life of a relative of Dr. Terence Rose. We also have for mention the Reverend Bosworth Mullings, who dearly wanted to share this experience, and the Reverend Eva Cox Williams of the Leeward Islands District. In a little while, we'll be hearing from, and we welcome the Reverend Everell Galbraith, our connectional bishop, and we trust that all of us, as we share together, will experience the power and the presence of God as we go through. From this point onwards, I'll be inviting now the Reverend Dr. Alison Eiton, or Dr. the Reverend Alison Eiton, to share with us.
We have an additional apology from Reverend Michael Llewellyn. I invite Bishop Everell Galbraith to come now and share a word from the connection.
Sisters and brothers, good morning. Let me, before I begin to say what I've prepared, I extend condolences on behalf of Reverend Horace Hector, who called this morning and asked me to ensure that I extend his condolences and sorrow for not being able to be here and to share with us. And also from the Reverend Jacqueline Liddell, who is on connectional duties in the United Kingdom. The Connectional Conference of the Methodist Church in the Caribbean and the Americas joins the Guyana, Belize, Honduras, and the Jamaica districts in paying tribute to the life and legacy of Sister Wendy Litchmore, a remarkable woman who epitomized the motto of the Methodist Women's League and dedicated herself to serving her home, her church, and community with unwavering sincerity and devotion. We take this opportunity to extend to Reverend Litchmore and the entire family members our sympathy, even as we join you in saying thanks to God for Sister Wendy's life among us, her competences, her kindness, her willingness to assist, her devotion, and an intrinsic calm, comforting, and conciliatory spirit that was always appreciated. Our hearts are heavy with grief, yet we find solace in celebrating the profound impact she has had on the lives she touched, and that she is with her Savior. When we shared the news of her transition with our son, Elroy, he asked, "Who, my godfather's wife?" You see, it is interesting that is how Elroy remembers her, because Sister Wendy was the one who kept his godfather, Reverend Litchmore, updated about Elroy's movements and accomplishments. As we got to know her, we recognized that this was her modus operandi. She poured her heart into nurturing, encouraging, and supporting others. With grace and wisdom, she guided children and youth, imparting invaluable life lessons and instilling in them a strong Christian moral compass. Mrs. Litchmore was a pillar of strength to her husband as she made many sacrifices in supporting him in the work God has called him to do. She was a dedicated wife. The MCCA is indeed grateful to her for her supportive role that she played. The impact of Sister Wendy extended far beyond the confines of her immediate circle. She dedicated countless hours to the Women's League in Guyana and here in Jamaica, to the MCCA women, and to ministers. She supported the activities of MCCA women, and interestingly, was among the first to register for the seminar that is to be held later this month. As a matter of fact, our trip, my wife and I, was planned prior to her passing to attend the seminar. So you can imagine the shock and confusion to be participating in this Thanksgiving service for her life, even as we continue to make plans to attend the seminar. I'm sure she will be missed. My wife remembers Sister Wendy as always working on a project to improve the life of others, whether it was organizing charitable events, leading prayer groups, or comforting the grieving. Sister Wendy embraced her role as a servant of God with humility, calm, and dedication and joy. In the wider community, she was a beacon of hope and a force for positive change in the lives of countless students and staff in the educational institutions where she served. As a Christian woman, She embodied the essence of love, compassion, and selflessness. Her life was a testament to the teachings of Christ as she lived each day in service to others. She understood the true meaning of faith, and she was definitely one for whom her actions spoke louder than words. We will remember her pleasant and infectious smile, her gentle spirit, and her unwavering faith. Her legacy will live on in the hearts of all who had the privilege of knowing her. Let us honor her by committing ourselves to follow in her footsteps, continuing the work she began. Let us honor her memory by embracing the values she held so dearly: love, kindness, service, selflessness, and compassion. And so today, we say our final goodbye. Commend her into God's keeping, and later on to lay her mortal remains to rest. As we do so, let us celebrate a life well lived. Though we mourn her passing, we take comfort in the knowledge that she now rests in the arms of her Heavenly Father. And we can truly say she has fought the good fight. She has finished her race. She has kept the faith. And Jesus will say to her on that day, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter the joy of the Lord." May she rest in eternal repose and rise in glory, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Mrs. Andrea Crossfield will come now and pay tribute on behalf of the MCCA Women and the Women's League, to be followed immediately by the MCCA Women's Hymn, and all MCCA Women will rise when we sing. Oh, it is Mrs. Angela Mullings who will do the tribute.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. This is a tribute in honor of Sister Wendy Litchmore. And this tribute comes from the members of the Women's League, its executive, the Jamaica District Methodist Church of the Caribbean and the Americas, and the members of the MCCA Women Executive Jamaica. Sister Wendy Pamela Litchmore, a woman of God, was born to fulfill her God-given purpose and to complete a mission that was ordained and directed by God. Sister Wendy was no stranger to women's work. Her work in the Guyana and Belize districts preceded her work in the Jamaica district in the large part, and bears witness to her amazing strength and resilience. Her steady and consistent work in God's vineyard reminds us of the glow from embers in a fire, shining and bright. Embers are long-lasting. They can cause a fire to spread quickly and reignite in places where it has already passed, by smoldering and then reigniting, and can exist within, remain after, or even precede a fire. It was no secret that this glow that was in Sister Wendy and in everything she did was the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit caused her to glow and make a difference wherever she went, igniting fires and motivating people to work. Not only did she start the fire, but whatever she planned was well executed. She saw it to full completion, leaving nothing hanging, nothing undone. Her thoroughness and love for accountability was unsurpassed, and she was a blessing to work with. Sister Wendy's confidence was in God, and she trusted in him for help and guidance. These traits were evident in her work. Sister Wendy worked in her local women's leagues in the circuits where she served beside her husband. The Reverend Barrington Litchmore, superintendent minister, and these circuits are the Claremont and Manchester circuits, the Providence circuit at the time of her death. Shortly after joining the Providence circuit in 2021, Sister Wendy began working with the women in the Dallas congregation to establish a branch of the Women's League. Her strong leadership qualities were further harnessed as Sister Wendy served on the national executive of the Women's League. Sister Wendy was always at meetings, listening attentively and following every word spoken carefully. We enjoyed sweet fellowship with her, whether we were at a residential retreat or a quarterly meeting of the National Women's League executive. Sister Wendy was seen making jokes and chatting with everyone, showing genuine concern for what was happening to members. She gave many of us strong spiritual support, and her advice was always spot on. Sister Wendy was a lady of order. We looked forward to her being the lunchtime hostess at the annual Women's League conference. She was an exceptional hostess and obviously had a system as she worked flawlessly to ensure each guest was served. This continued up to this year at our conference held on April 23rd. Sister Wendy served the MCCA Women Executive Jamaica with equal passion up to the time of her passing, and was a member of the planning committee of the Caribbean Regional Seminar scheduled for the end of July 2023. She undertook the responsibility for organizing accommodation and transportation of overseas conference delegates. Sister Wendy also chaired the organizing committee for the MCCA Jamaica annual virtual tea party. A large part of its success was due to her outstanding attention to detail. She had a system of ticket distribution that was unparalleled. We remember last year's efforts very well. As each challenge came, Sister Wendy figured out a way to work around it. We had a time difference challenge, as not all the members of her committee were resident in Jamaica during the planning phase. Sister Wendy did not give up. It meant she had to make telephone calls early in the morning or late at night, but the communications continued almost daily. That year, the vote of thanks at the Tea Party came from Paris. Being far away did not exempt the committee member from participating, even at 2 a.m. in the morning local time. Her outreach activities extended beyond her work in the Leagues and the MCCA to the Methodist Home for Retired Persons, where she interacted with the residents by visiting on Wednesdays for devotions, craft, and other recreational activities. So, this is just a small part of our journey with Sister Wendy. We will continue to remember her excellent work in many spheres. We learned from her to work fiercely for God and to never give up or never give in. We learned that challenges will come, but with God's help to keep calm and carry on. This mighty woman of God has left us with a glow which continues. She has ignited many ideas within us, individually and as an organization, that will remain with us. She has left much work that will be continued in the mighty name of Jesus. So, with purpose fulfilled, mission accomplished, she is now with her God and Savior, Yeshua Adonai, the living God, the God of Abraham, the all-powerful, the all-knowing, the everlasting God. Rest in peace, Sister Wendy, and may God's eternal light shine on you. We miss you. Thank you.
MCCA woman, please stand. The tributes will flow as printed in our order of service. Sister Alcyon Crosdale on behalf of Dallas Methodist Church. Regeneration Music will lift a choral tribute. Mrs. Varma Litchmore and others identified will come on behalf of friend and family. Mrs. Jennifer Cumberbatch on behalf of the Education Fraternity of the Republic of Guyana. canon, Georgia Jervis will lift a choral tribute, followed by Sister Wendy's sister, Barbara Moore, who will share the eulogy.
Before I read the tribute from Dallas, let me read one from the Manchester circuit. Sister Wendy Litchmore came to us in the Manchester circuit as a humble, loving, people person with a servant's heart. She made herself a part of existing ministries, programs in the church. One such ministry was the mentoring program for young men and women of the Foundation for Lifelong Learning, now Heart Trust. She helped to conduct devotions, taught mathematics and English, counseled, and helped them to find summer jobs. Sister Wendy would also refer them to higher education and shared in their joys as she saw some three of them getting full jobs. She became an active member of the Women's League and was appointed as vice president. She was particularly helpful in them preparing projects for District Women's Conference. Sister Wendy also got involved with the Wednesday Circle, which is another female organization of the Wesley Mandeville congregation. May her soul rest in peace. Tribute to Mrs. Wendy Litchmore from Dallas Methodist Church. The Word of God contains numerous verses with instructions on how we should use or spend our time. Ephesians 5, 15 to 17 says, we should make the best use of our time. We should look carefully how we walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of time. The writer of Psalm 90:12 challenges us to realize that our days are few and to use our time wisely. In summary, the quality of our time is more important than the length of our time. These sentiments were expressed by the adults, as well. Her presence among them and the way she shared brought such warmth and joy. The love she shared made any sadness disappear. She was a giver, and they always looked forward to meeting her. Today, I am honored to pay tribute to one whose time of fellowship with the Dallas Methodist Church, though very short, was very impactful. One who seemed to take every opportunity to build up and encourage those in the faith and in service to God, Mrs. Wendy Litchmore. Since her passing, the members of the congregation met to remember her and reflect on the time she shared with us. The children and young people, as well as the adults, participated willingly. The children and young people remembered her as Auntie Wendy, a humble person and one who was kind to children and young people. She knew how to make you feel special and loved. They appreciated her gifts to the members of the cradle roll. She has shown by example how the work among this age group can be developed. The sentiments were expressed by the adults as well. Her presence among them and the way she shared brought such warmth and joy. The love she shared made any sadness disappear. She was a giver, and they always looked forward to meeting her. Behind the warmth, the joy, the caring, and sharing, she was also a non-nonsense person. She was disciplined and orderly, and encouraged others to be likewise. She knew how to use her God-given gifts to encourage and chastise and encourage others to identify their strengths and weaknesses without feeling humiliated. She never made a promise that she did not keep. Her input into our cradle role department within the Dallas Methodist Church will never be forgotten, and we will surely continue to build on the foundation she has laid in this area of service. The way she interacted with us made us realize that she felt welcome as a part of our Dallas church family. We were all delighted when she and Reverend Litchmore accepted our invitation to share our 2022 Christmas morning breakfast with us. For her, deeds were more important than words. The women of the church will always remember the time spent organizing the group of 12 into the Dallas Methodist Church Women's League. Unfortunately, our first enrollment, which was scheduled for April this year, had to be rescheduled to September. We are still like babes in the era of our church work, and Sister Wendy's departure from us has definitely created a void. To our Methodist sisters who are members of well-established groups, please include us in your outreach program. We are committed, and with your help, will be successful. Sister Wendy made very good use of the short time she shared with us at Dallas Methodist Church. This short tribute to her brings to mind the poem, The Dash, written by Linda Ellis. The dash was the term used to define one's lifespan, from the date of birth to the date of death. For us, her dash among us at Dallas Methodist Church was short, but impactful, and we give all glory, honor, and praise to Almighty God for it. The poem, The Dash, not only a reflection of the life of Sister Wendy, but a reminder to all of us to be wise and to live our lives in a way that is pleasing to God. What matters most is how we love, serve, and live. For us at Dallas, that short dash representing Sister Wendy's time with us meant much. She did not procrastinate. Let us pray to our Heavenly Father in the words of Psalm 90, verse 2. Lord, teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Brothers and sisters, the poem continues by encouraging us to reflect long and hard and act on what we would like to change. For the extra busy ones among us, to slow down and consider what's true and real, to try to understand how others feel, to be less quick to anger, to show appreciation more, to show respect, to love people in our lives, and remember that our special dash will only last a while. Sister Wendy, your loving and caring spirit will forever be remembered. May you rest in peace and rise in glory.
Amen. upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name.
And there I find you in the mystery, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, where
Reverend Litchmore had asked me to read a tribute from Wendy's friend who lives in the USA. So I've asked his niece, Jody, to read it,
And then Rachel, my daughter, will read my tribute.
Good morning, everyone. A tribute for Wendy from Tessa Abrams. It is with great sadness that I write this tribute on behalf of my dear friend Wendy. Wendy was an extraordinary woman with many successful qualities. She was a dedicated wife and a lifelong teacher. But her rare qualities extended far beyond the classroom as she dealt with people from all walks of life. She had this ability to correct and encourage persons without them feeling embarrassed. She was kind in her words and patient with others, offering a listening ear and comforting presence. Wendy had great respect for the church, and she was involved in many organizations. She cherished family values. Wendy began her teaching career as a pupil teacher in Guyana and moved along the ranks to become a head teacher. She was a dedicated teacher, and she fostered in her students a sense of belonging, compassion, and empathy. She was a woman who loved, valued kindness, integrity, and perseverance. As we mourn the passing of Wendy, let us also celebrate the gift of her life. Let us remember the laughter, the joy, and the countless memories that we shared. Let us honor her unwavering dedication to education and the profound impact she had on many lives. Though Wendy is not with us in this physical realm, she is here with us in spirit. Wendy's life was certainly a full-blown flower cut down too soon. She left memories to be cherished and examples to follow. She will be dearly missed. May she rest in eternal peace, knowing that she left an indelible imprint on this world. Psalms 34 and 18 says, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit." Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My mother mentioned, my name is Rachel, and I'll be reading her tribute on her behalf. W, woman of God, faithful Christian. E, empathetic, encourager to family members. N, nurturing, non-judgmental teacher. D, dedicated, dependable, devoted wife. Y, yielding friend. My journey with Wendy began in 1991 when the children, Binzi and I, went to Guyana to celebrate her marriage to my brother-in-law, Barry, or Reverend Litchmore. It was a very busy occasion, but even in the few moments that I shared with Wendy at the time, I was compelled by her kind and gentle spirit. Our friendship grew between 1991 and 2000 during their many trips to Jamaica. She was very supportive and participated enthusiastically in our family activities, including weddings and birthday parties. On one of their visits, our family decided to throw a surprise appreciation party for her husband, Barry. Wendy was extremely enthusiastic about this idea and did everything in her power to assist us. Even though she could not drive, she played the role of distractor throughout this day, accompanying him to Hope Gardens and other sites. If she could have herself driven that day, she would have taken him wherever he wanted to go so that the party could have been the biggest surprise ever. Wendy also had an ability to recognize and honor people's skills and talents. For example, during that time period, I was a seamstress. Wendy was so appreciative of my skills that even though she lived across the ocean in Guyana, she would still ask me to sew her work clothes, which Barry would collect for her on his frequent visits to Jamaica. My family immigrated to Canada in 2001, and during the almost 10-year time period between then and when she and Barry would eventually move back to Jamaica, our friendship slowly grew through their visits to Canada and our occasional phone conversations. Reverend Litchmore returned to Jamaica with Wendy in 2010, and given my recent return to Jamaica as well, our friendship finally had the opportunity to blossom. Wendy had been excited about the move to Jamaica, knowing that she would have had me as a friend and support, and was consequently disappointed when she learned that she and Barry would be living in St. Anne, a significant distance away from my home in Kingston. However, the distance did not deter us. Whenever she visited my home, we would have devotion together in the morning, and we continued this practice on the phone many times. We also spoke every day on the phone, which allowed me to become familiar with her daily routines, including what occurred during her work day. Their move to Kingston occurred after she had retired from her years of teaching and administrative leadership, which allowed me to become even more familiar with her daily self-care routine. This included walking every morning, watering the plants, and daily devotion, eventually getting some rest after performing some house maintenance chores. She also shared the loving routines that she would have with her husband. If he made breakfast, she would set the table and do the fruits. I appreciated these simple moments of sharing, as I would share my routines as well. These conversations allowed me a deeper insight into who Wendy was as a caring and faithful family-oriented woman with a strong and kind spirit. Wendy lived out the fruits of the spirit. She was generous, long-suffering, patient, gentle, kind, had self-control, love, and faith. She was generous, always supporting children and seniors. Her last visit to the Dallas congregation was on Cradle Roll Sunday. Wendy ensured that she went shopping for the children and took them gifts. Last year, while I was overseas, she called to let me know that a student that she had been assisting with school supplies and clothes when she taught in St. Anne was about to graduate from high school. He was an A student and needed financial assistance for graduation. While she did not have the money readily at hand, she decided to make a sacrifice and sent his family what they had asked for. A few days later, she called me to let me know that she had received a blessing from one of her friends, which was twice the amount that she had given to the young man. Wendy was also faithful. She was asked to assist with devotion at a senior's home managed by the church. She went every other Wednesday, and at times, when the other person responsible was not able to make it, she would go in their place. At times, she was not feeling well, but she still went. She said that the ladies were depending on her, and she did not want to disappoint them. These women were consequently very protective of Wendy. One Wednesday, when I went to pick her up from the home, when I got close to the gate, about two ladies stood there with her. They wanted to see who was picking her up, as they were afraid that she might get hurt. Wendy demonstrated another fruit of the spirit, self-control, in many situations. She rarely became angry and did not give advice. She only made suggestions on how things could be done differently. She would say, "Rita, I would say this or I would do that," never pushing her opinion or point of view as the right or correct one. This is something that I greatly admired about her. Wendy was above all things loving. She always inquired about and showed love and concern for my children and grandchildren, as well as for her nieces, nephews, grandnieces, and nephews. We would share pictures and videos on important milestones in their lives. Wendy also took great care of our mother-in-law, Mrs. Harrison Litchmore, selflessly giving of herself to take care of her and all of her needs during the time that she lived with Barry and herself here in Jamaica. Wendy expressed to me sometime in April that she was not feeling well. On the 8th of June, I spent some time with her and prayed with her every day until the 14th, when I intended to visit her again. Unfortunately, due to a last-minute conflict, I couldn't go. And when I called to let her know, I asked her how she was doing. She expressed to my surprise that she was feeling bad, which was the first time I've ever heard her speak so plainly about her condition. I was so surprised that I asked her again. At which point she said, "Not bad." We both lapsed into silence, at first in our conversations, which gave me the feeling that something was different. I therefore went on to ask her if she had spoken to her sisters. She said that she responded that she had been trying to reach her sister Des, as it was her birthday, and that she had been unable to reach her to wish her happy birthday. I let her know that I planned to visit her. Mommy gave this to me because she was afraid that she was going to cry. I let her know that I had planned to visit her the next day, and this is when she reminded me that she had an appointment at the hospital that day. I therefore told her that I wanted to visit her on Friday instead. I woke up with her on my mind on Thursday, remembering that she was to be in the hospital, but by the end of the day, I learned that she had passed. Wendy, my friend, confidant, and sister, we will never meet again in this side of heaven, but I hope to meet you on the beautiful shore. So rest in peace, my sister, and may God's light perpetually shine on you.
Morning, church. My tribute comes on behalf of Mr. or several Fred Success, who worked many years with Aunt Wendy at the West Rumbelt Primary School. It is always very difficult to bid farewell to someone whom you've interacted with for a substantial period of time, as well as to realize that that departure is permanent. True, death has been part and parcel, the very fabric of our society. Yet, when it appears on the horizon, we find ourselves unable to deal with it. Someone once wrote that death leaves a heartache no one can heal. Love leaves a memory no one can steal. Even as I pen these thoughts, I feel caught up in the reality that it is appointed unto men once to die, but still saddened that I have lost a colleague, a sister, a stalwart, a cheerleader, and an influencer. Truth be told, the fact that Mrs. Litchmore has departed this present life leaves a void that time nor memory may never erase. She was charming and kind, a genuine friend, scholarly yet humble, not discriminatory, but is always willing to highlight the good in others. I believe that many of us began missing Mrs. Litchmore since she left Guyana, but she always kept in contact, and we were extremely happy whenever she made periodic visits to her homeland. Dorothy Ferguson said, "Only a moment you stayed, but what an imprint your footprints have left in our hearts." I was introduced to Mrs. Wendy Litchmore 2 days after she assumed duty at West Rumbelt Primary School on Monday, the 4th of September, 2000. I was still overseas on that day and had called the school and heard this soft, peaceful voice that would eventually be the central voice of authority for the next 9 years. Suffice it to say, Mrs. Litchmore was granted early retirement in 2009 to migrate to Jamaica at the end of her husband's stint with the Methodist Church of Guyana. By the end of her very hardworking and successful tenure at West Ramville Primary, she had transformed this inner city school from slum status to a beacon of hope and light. In fact, when she assumed duty, she met a school in crisis, divided over the appointment of one senior over another, which threatened to spiral out of control and break up the school. But instead of panicking on this initial baptism of fire, she saw the wisdom and guidance of God and was able to provide sage counsel that harmonized the feuding parties. From that moment, confidence was restored in the school, and she was able to garner the support of the staff, the pupils, parents, and corporate community. Under her tenure, the school won a number of firsts in academia, social endeavors, community, and cultural activities, along with environmental enhancement. She worked untiringly to create a loving and caring environment in the school and used her vast experience as an educator to ensure that learners acquire a mastery of the requisite outcomes of the national curriculum. Always, she celebrated the success of her students and inspired her staff to walk the extra mile for the development and empowerment of learners. She taught us the value of prayer and encouraged us to all strengthen our faith in God. She was my strongest cheerleader and was happy to share in the success of the students of my own school. We would talk for long hours on strategies that could be implemented to promote a better education for young learners. To us who had the pleasant fortune of interacting with Mrs. Litchmore, we have lost a champion, a devoted leader, a prudent educator, a godly Christian woman. While it is difficult to come to terms with her early passing, we understand that the Heavenly Father knows best. Indeed, Mrs. Litchmore dedicated her life for the development of the children of Guyana, and the evidence is glaring for all to see. Positive things occurred when she was at the helm at West, and we were all beneficiaries of God's goodness to her. We have the hope of uniting with her someday in the sweet by and by. We believe that Jesus, whom she loved and served, has already welcomed her into his abode. We know that she will be at peace in our Master's arms. As such, we endorse the sentiments of this anonymous writer who once posited, "Those we love don't go away. They walk beside us every day. Unseen, unheard, but always near. Still loved, still missed, and very dear." Goodbye, Mrs. Litchmore.
Hallelujah. We love you, Lord, for your mercy's never failed her in all her days, have been held in your hands from the moment that she rose up until she's now laid her head. We will sing of the goodness of God.
First, please allow me to read a tribute sent by the Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Education. He has named it, of Guyana, that is, and he has named it a tribute to an extraordinary woman who embodied love and generosity. Sister Wendy, as he called her, was a model of love, compassion, and generosity until her very last moments with us on earth. Her mission was one that made a difference in the lives of many people. The great number of people who attended the nights of tribute, that says a lot about the kind of person that she was. She wasn't a celebrity or a well-known political figure. But her death wasn't mentioned in the newspapers or on the radio. However, her departure touched many. She spent her whole life helping others. She was always there for those who were in need, whether they needed to take shelter in her home during a difficult time or simply wanted an ear that would listen without judging, condemning, or prejudging. She was a reassuring presence for her mother, of whom she took great care, as well as her husband, her friends, her work colleagues, and her entire family. She was well known and admired in her community. Some of the qualities she mastered were authenticity, humility, generosity, respect of others and of herself, and integrity. She continually expressed her love for others. Her mission was a great one. She taught others around her the importance of loving and of not being afraid of showing it. All of her relationships were transformed by that single ingredient, love, love of others, the most essential ingredient of her time here on earth. the best remedy for a difficult event and that turns our lives upside down is to give love freely. The death of his cousin Wendy has really brought home to him that when we leave this world, our material goods, rules, titles, and profits no longer matter. All that counts when we leave, when we have completed our mission, is that we loved fully. And while there are many words to describe her, I choose to use extraordinary because it is the one word that really describes her best. She was considered to be a mentor, a great teacher, a strategist, and a real kind and generous person. One of her exceptional achievements was that of making everyone, whether they be teachers, parents, or learners alike, believe that with hard work, commitment, and dedication and excellence, excellence can be achieved. This was demonstrated for over the many years that turned this unrecognized school, as you heard before, West Randwell, in relation to the National Grade 6 Assessment achievements to the top primary school nationally, and at that time, the primary school of choice. The West Randwell Primary School, at a time when we know top schools were in the north of Georgetown. This was the first one in the south of Georgetown. The impact she had on our lives is immeasurable, and we are forever grateful. Your teachings will always resonate, making you a presence that never really truly leaves us. The world has lost a great educator and teacher, but your legacy will continue to live on through your students and the many lives you would have touched. May the good Lord bless and keep. Rest in peace, Sister Wendy. Much love. And that's the tribute from Alfred King, Mr. Alfred King, who is the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Education. I now read you the tribute to Mrs. Wendy Litchmore, a short tribute on behalf of the Ministry of Education. Mrs. Wendy Pamela Litchmore, then Miss Wendy Harris, started her teaching career as a pupil teacher at the Cane Grove Government School in February 1973. She was just 16, going on 17 years old. She improved her status to assistant mistress in 1980 after attending the Government Teachers Training College. She was transferred to Anne's Grove Primary School, where she served for six years, teaching the little ones within the early childhood category. Mrs. Litchmore continued to distinguish herself as an expert teacher of children in the tender ages and in the foundation stages, as she moved on to Grove, Craig, and the New Amsterdam Primary Schools, rising to the status of non-graduate senior mistress. She graciously moved among schools in various communities in which her husband, Reverend Barrington Litchmore, served. She worked at Buxton Primary School in 1994 and in St. Philip's and Freeburg Primary Schools as non-graduate senior mistress, gaining more knowledge and skills, not only in the art of teaching, but in the effective management of schools as well. As an ambitious and forward-looking educator, Mrs. Litchmore attended the University of Guyana during the period 1995 to 1999. That's where I met her, and we became real sisters, not just in the Lord, but real sisters and friends. She received her bachelor's in education in teaching and education management with distinction, even while at St. Winifred School, acting as graduate deputy head teacher. For a short period, she served at the Leonora Primary School, then came to a very momentous appointment in her life, and that is as head teacher She was appointed as head teacher, graduate head teacher of the West Rheinfeld Primary School. She, with her wisdom, skill, and knowledge, and vast experience, as you would have heard from the various schools, along with teachers of excellence, such as her dear friend and colleague, Mr. Wilfred Success, from whom you heard a tribute read, transformed the entire school from being a school that had begun to disintegrate in the 90s to a school that all and sundry wanted to attend, and that was a feat. A school of which the Ministry of Education was greatly proud. Under her stewardship, the staff was united and worked together to make the school a true place of learning. West Rheinfeld Primary School produced many of the top students in the years that she was there, and the outstanding boys' choir was one that was sought after for performance at many national events and cultural events, bringing back lots of trophies for their sterling performances in the arts. The Ministry of Education recognized her as one of its particularly outstanding head teachers who led by example and after whom many tried to emulate. The school, the education system, lost a giant when she proceeded on early retirement in 2009. The many head teachers, education officers, and other teachers do give their, I should say our, because I was a head teacher in her time, condolences to her husband, Reverend Barrington Litchmore, her brothers, sisters, many nieces and nephews, cousins, indeed all of the relatives and friends, and there are many, and the church members. As they reminisce from time to time on her service of distinction to the nation's children. She has left a legacy that many speak about to this day. She has left a legacy of being impactful, of professionalism, dedication and commitment, determination to achieve goals, great administrative and management skills, mentorship, and her support to others. May her soul, her dear soul, rest in peace. God bless you.
If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can show somebody he is traveling around, then my living shall be if I can help somebody as I pass alone, then my living shall not be in Christian art. If I can bring back beauty to a world apart, if I can spread love's message that shall not be in vain, then my living shall not be in vain, then my living shall
ago. And he has now taken the second one. Here is Hazel. She is after Wendy. And this is Violet, the one after Hazel. This is Cindy, our cousin. But for many years, Wendy lived with Cindy after her mother passed and she was living alone. So Cindy is our sister as well. And so I present to you, I am Barbara, as I've been reminded by you. And many persons will hear me being called theirs, because for some reason, my mother, after naming me Barbara, called me Desiree, and my siblings said Des,
and everybody knows this. We're here to eulogize and remember our sister Wendy. Some things would be repeated, but that can't be helped because she was who she was. Wendy Pamela Litchmore, née Harris, born on the 26th of June 1956, was the second of six children born to the late Charles and Rona Harris at Chapman's Grove, Unity Village, East Coast, Demerara. Her siblings, Barbara, Hazel, Violet, and Richard, Olive and Olive, now deceased. She received her early childhood education at the Unity Kindergarten School and later the Ansgrove Methodist School. Having completed her primary education at the Ansgrove Methodist School, Wendy's career as a teacher began at the Cane Grove Government School, where she was appointed a pupil teacher on the 2nd of February, 1973. However, she was a teacher long before this appointment, as she played school with the children from our neighborhood and her younger siblings. When there were no children, she had imaginary ones and even spoke to the step treaders and the plants in the yard. Such was her love for imparting knowledge that she dedicated 36 years of her life to the education sector of her country of birth, Guyana. Wendy taught at 10 schools across the country, as far as New Amsterdam, Belize, east and west coast of Demerara, east bank of Demerara, as well as in and around the Georgetown. One may ask the question, why she moved around to so many different schools across the country? There is an explanation. Sometime in the early 1990s, her heart was stolen by a handsome young Methodist minister, the love of her life, Reverend Barrington Oliver Litchmore. They were married on the 16th of February 1991. Whenever and wherever the church sent her husband, Wendy graciously went. She settled into each new man's school and community. The young girl, who began as a pupil teacher in 1973, developed and upgraded herself over the years. And in 1999, she received her bachelor's degree in education with an excellent grade point average. In September 2000, she was designated graduate headmistress A and appointed headmistress of the West Rhineveld Primary School, a post she held for 9 years. During her tenure at West Rhineveld, the school produced children who were among the top 10 performers at the secondary school's entrance examination, or the National Grade 6 assessment, 7 times. With West Rhineveld Primary producing the top students in 2001, and coincidentally, that top student in 2001 was our nephew, Jason Johnson. You heard his brother earlier, and this is his mother. In 2002-2004, in 2007, one of her students finished second in the inaugural National Grade 6 assessment. Under her leadership, West Rhineveld Primary became the most revered primary school in the country. All the accolades, however, did not cause Wendy to lose the common touch. She took an interest in the welfare of everyone under her charge, students and teachers alike. As a daughter, Wendy took special interest in the care and well-being of her parents. She was the one watching over her father while her mother was out at her business. She witnessed his passing and dealt with the trauma until her mother got home. When her mother was ill, Wendy was always questioning the rest of us siblings. What more could we do to keep our mother going and comforted? She also took care of her mother-in-law, ensuring that she stuck to her diet and that her medications were always administered. As a sister, Wendy cared for all of us. Whatever the circumstance, she was always willing and ready to offer advice and support. For her, there was always a solution. She encouraged all of us in whatever we set out to do. When our youngest sister, Olive, became terminally ill, Wendy took leave from her job and went to the United States to take care of her until the time of her passing. As an aunt, she took special interest in our children. Their education and career paths were always of great concern to her, even though she was far away here in Jamaica. Social media kept her abreast with what educational opportunities were available in Guyana, and she pushed and pressured them to make the best of every opportunity. I now share some thoughts from her niece and nephews. From Leona, our brother's daughter, referring to her Auntie Wendy. She was my motivator. She is the reason and the person I am today. She has made a positive impact in my life, and I will forever remember her, even in death. I am really sorry she won't be here to see that her dream came true through me. She has always encouraged me to elevate myself, and I promise I will. I must let you know, Leona is now in Teachers College, all because she was encouraged by Wendy. From Jeremy, Hazel's son, Auntie Wendy nourished my soul with unyielding devotion. She ensured that I attended summer camp, VBS, and church services. Her unwavering faith in God inspired me to seek solace and peace within my own spiritual journey. From Marvin, Auntie Wendy was a second mother to my younger brother Jason and I, as we lived most of our childhood with her and Uncle Barry. This demonstrated her loving kindness to take on such a responsibility, not forgetting Uncle Barry's love for his wife in accepting two young boys into his home. Living with her over the years molded me into the person that I am today. Apart from teaching us how to manage our financial resources, she also introduced us to social graces, such as setting the table for meals, even though we were boys. She valued education and encouraged us to study at every opportunity. From Sean, my son, family was very important to Auntie Wendy. She always encouraged me to make my family a priority. In our last conversation, she implored me to spend more time with my family. Last December, Wendy was extremely happy when two of her nephews and one of her great nieces all graduated from the University of Guyana. As the wife of a minister and a godly woman, Wendy embraced the work of the church being part of several committees, both in Guyana and in Jamaica, with special interest in women's work. While at the Kingston congregation, she also, with some ladies, started a class in remedial teaching for children of the community. Wendy graciously and generously hosted both serving and student ministers, showering them with the kind of hospitality only Wendy Litchmore possessed. In 2009, when Barry went to England on study leave, Wendy went to Belize and took up an appointment as a resource teacher for the Methodist schools there. On his return from study leave in 2010, Barry was stationed at the Beachamville-Bensington Circuit in the Jamaica District. Wendy joined her husband and continued to support him in his ministry by becoming very involved in the work of the church in this district. Between 2011 and 2016, Wendy taught at Irons Mountain Primary School, Golden Grove Primary School, and Alderton Primary and Infant School, and retired a second time from the teaching profession in December 2016. Thereafter, she was employed on a contractual basis by the University of the Commonwealth Caribbean to supervise and assist teachers pursuing their bachelor's in education program. At her retirement from the Alderton Primary and Infant School, she was presented with a plaque bearing the following citation, and I quote, "A stalwart and trailblazer in education, one who was not discouraged by challenges within the classroom and was always affirmative in her passion to create avenues for her students to reach their maximum potential," end of quote. This really sums up who Wendy was in her approach to teaching and managing classrooms and schools wherever she went. Many teachers, young and old alike, were mothered and nurtured by her. Wendy was the kind of person who not only got to know an individual, but often inquired about their family and would offer assistance to ministers, spouses, and children as if they were her own flesh and blood. Wendy has left an indelible mark on everyone who has come into contact with her. She has numerous godchildren. Wendy honored God by obeying his command, as stated in John 21:7, where Jesus said to Peter, "Feed my sheep." This she certainly did. Her life's journey came to an end on the 15th of June, 2023. Wendy bore her illness with dignity and grace, with unwavering faith in her God. And before I close, I was the one she was trying to reach on the 14th. When I got home, because I did not have Wi-Fi and I was out, I saw the missed call. And I called and she answered, but I realized that she was really not well. She was groaning and groaning deeply. I questioned her about how she was feeling and she responded. She always spoke about a discomfort in her stomach. And I asked her, "Is it the discomfort?" And she said, "It's more like pain." And I said to her, "You know, I wish I was there to help you. But if it means coming to Jamaica, I'll come." And then I told her, "Let's pray. Let me pray for her." And so I prayed. And we repeated the Lord's Prayer together. And then I said the benediction. I did not know that that would be the last time I would hear my sister's voice. But I thank God that we spent those last moments in prayer, that I was able to hear her voice repeating the Lord's Prayer. I give God praise and thanks. We give God praise and thanks for her. Sleep on and take your rest, our beloved, until we meet at Jesus' feet. We love you, but Jesus loves you best. Thank you.
Amen.
The offertory will now be collected on behalf of MCCA Women's Ministries. We will be singing two hymns, and I will indicate to you when the congregation will stand before we bless the offering.
Let us pray. What an assurance we have, O God, that you lead us. What an assurance we have, O God, that you have placed us here for a purpose. And so, God, as we bless your name for the life of Sister Wendy, we thank you, O God, that she offered her all to you, that her life was a testimony of how impactful we can be when first of all we surrender to you, Almighty God, and allow you to lead us. So here we offer to you our offering, O God, for the work of the ministry of the MCCA women. There are so many across our nation, our countries, our districts, that are serving you in meaningful ways. We pray, God, that even as you bless them for this financial offering, that you will bless the lives, those who have grown weary, inspire them with the life of Sister Wendy. Those who are working, remind them, oh God, that whatever they do it as unto you. Bless our offering, we pray. Receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated as we listen to the word of God.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Verses 1 through 11. Here begins the reading. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The first epistle reading is taken from Philippians 3, verses 12 through 16, Philippians 4, verses 4 through 13. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to lay hold of that for which Christ has laid hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider that I have laid hold of it, but one thing I have laid hold of, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal, toward the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us then who are mature think this way. And if you think differently about anything, this too God will reveal to you. Only let us hold fast to what we have attained. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Philippians 4, verses 4 through 13. Verse 5, let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there anything worthy of praise, think about these things. As for the things that you have learned and received and heard and noticed in me, do them, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned for me, but had no opportunity to show it. Not that I'm referring to being in need, for I have learned to be content with whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well-fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Here endeth the reading of God's word. We say, thanks be to God.
Lord, I will Please stand for the gospel reading from John chapter 11, verses 17 through to 27.
Glory to you, O God.
When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise be to Christ, O Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia.
From a word that was sent by two other persons from Guyana. Says, "I have known you for a long time, a long, long time. Our friendship became closer during our years at the University of Guyana. Your life was a blessing. Your memory will remain in our hearts. We are deeply saddened by your loss, but grateful for the time we spent together. Our beloved friend, you may have left us far too soon, but your loving presence will endure forever in our hearts and souls. We will hold dearly the memory shared during our last visit with you in May of 2022. May your sweet soul rest in peace and rise in glory. Our heartfelt sympathy goes out to Reverend Litchmore, her friends and family." And this comes from Reverend Ablami and Donnet Latea. Let me just also apologize for the absence of our brother, Sean Davis, who is conducting a funeral service, which I should have been doing over in Buff Bay today, but he kindly consented to do so on my behalf so that I could have been here to share with my brother Barry on the passing of my neighbor and also his dear wife, Wendy. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Father, we just bless your name and thank you so much that you continue to love us and that you continue to be such a faithful friend in all the changing scenes of our lives. And now, Lord God, even as we share, as we continue to listen, and to celebrate the life of our beloved sister, we pray that the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts will be found acceptable and pleasing unto you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Reverend Litchmore, you know the sympathies of our family is extended to you at this time. And I should also say for your many colleagues who are watching online and those who were not able to be here with you. There are some words that I'm going to start with that comes from Charles Wesley, but words I believe uttered by Sister Wendy as she fulfilled her various tasks, mindful that the glory belonged to her Heavenly Father. In our Methodist hymn book, it says, it's number 595, it says, whate'er I say or do, the glory be, thy glory be my aim, my offerings all be offered through thy ever blessed name. Jesus, my single eye, be fixed on thee alone. Thy name be praised on earth on high, thy will by all be done. And so we continue, even as we have gathered here today, to celebrate not just our sister's life, but the presence of God who kept her on her journey and whose enabling grace continued to sustain her. We are going to listen now, Sister Lilith. We're trying to find Godfrey. My brother has disappeared, so we're going to find him just now. Brother Godfrey, maybe he just stepped away for a little bit. While we are waiting for him to come, I think Sister Lilith will just let me know when he has come back. But I share with us from the book of Ecclesiastes that was read earlier for us. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. I share with us on the topic of what time is it in this season of your life and of my life. For everything there is a season and a time. For every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. In an instant, in one short sentence, the author has expressed how fragile life is. There is a time to be born and a time to die. It may be that the most important question we can answer is, what time is it? We know that we are creatures of time by the way we set our clocks and watches so that we will know what hour it is. We have schedules and appointments set by dates on a calendar. We know larger amounts of time by measuring the months and the years. We also know the seasons of spring, summer, fall, and winter. But perhaps time should be measured in more than hours or days or even years. We have a measurement of time based upon what has happened within the life of any particular person. We may acknowledge that this person lived only for a short time, that the years were cut short. Others may conclude that the individual lived a full, long life. However, life is not life, much more than the measurement of years or the accomplishments. And as we reflect on Sister Wendy's life, I want us to listen to this song in particular.
Thank you.
Sister Lilith, because I could not have sung it so well, Sir Barry. I could not even have sung it at all. But I give God thanks. And that was just my song that I wanted to have for you and for, as we reflected on Wendy, and as we reflected on the memories as family members that you have shared over all these years in the journey of her life. And as we continue to reflect on what time is it, perhaps our lives should be measured by the relationships that we have with others. When we consider the impact they have made, the impression, the indelible marks left upon our lives that time can never erase, but it remains within our hearts and our minds for as long as we are alive. Isn't this the impact that draws us to times of celebrations for the lives of those who have left such an indelible mark upon us? If I dare to say, that is why you are here today, that's why I am here today, isn't it? Because we knew Teacher Wendy, Auntie Wendy, sister, colleague, friend, wife, and we can attach so many other names to her, mother, for the many she adopted. You are family, you are friends, and you have come to say goodbye to someone you knew and loved. That is important, and it is reflected in your presence. But let me ask, what is time for you today? The writer of Ecclesiastes has said, there is time and there is a season for every event under heaven. There is a time to weep and a time to mourn. And I would say for you who are family members and friends, that today is a day of mourning. You have lost a loved one and it hurts. Please do not deny your feelings, grieve, and grieve to the fullest. For through your grieving or during this time of grieving, healing will be taking place. Today, as we reflect on chapter 3 of the book, we take note of the fact that this passage is, first of all, very sobering and realistic and pragmatic, and it is a window into a philosopher's reflection on life. It is realistic because life comprises beauty, joy, mountaintop experiences, but there are also seasons of pain, loss, and heaviness. Solomon, who was considered the wisest man, wanted to remind every reader that death is a part of the circle of life and admonishes us, and I quote, "Do not fritter away your days because you will not be here forever," end of quote. The fact is, no one is exempt from life's shifting rhythms of time. We are not in control, as this passage demonstrates. Not of the specific time of our birth, neither the specific time of our death. I'm reminded of Psalm 90 and verse 12, which says, "Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom." Moses, here at the end of his journey, admonishes the Israelites to examine their lives and not to live like those who are ignorant that the time will come when we will have to give an account for the way we have lived our lives. And we heard about the dash when Sister Alcyon was sharing from Dallas. Therefore, we should choose to consciously live our lives, not tearing down, but building up others. Wendy Pomelo lived her life with that kind of consciousness that motivated her to be constantly pouring into the lives of others, guiding others, encouraging others, enabling them to develop their fullest potential and becoming their best selves by way of achievement and self-actualization. What time is it for you? What time is it for me? What season are we living in at this moment? I dare to say that today is not only a day of mourning, but today is a time of remembering. And that's what we have been doing through the tributes. I have often felt and expressed that funerals or Thanksgiving services are bittersweet because they are. They are bitter because you have lost a loved one. They are sweet because we have so many memories to share. And I'm thankful to God that He has given us the capacity to be able to recall. We can think of the good times, the funny moments of humor, the experiences, yes, the bad times too. And in remembering, we are able to celebrate the life of one who we knew and loved. Today is a time of remembering. Today is such a time of recall. But not just a day of remembering, but today is also a day of comfort. It is a day of comfort because Jesus said, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will return and take you to be with me if you believe in me." I dare say that even in the midst of death, if we believe in him, he will never leave us or forsake us. Isn't that encouraging news for us? Yes, it is. He who faced death himself and conquered it, he didn't just face it, he conquered it, will never leave us. And that says something to us. You see, that is the Easter message, or the essence of the Easter message. The tomb where they laid him today is empty. There is no one there. And the scripture tells us that if we believe in him, we will be raised with him also. As in Adam all dies, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. This is assurance. This is comfort. Whenever we face the challenges of illness and death, the psalmist reminds us, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, as harsh as it is, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. I had the wonderful opportunity of spending time with someone just about 2 days ago who has been, or who is going through terminal illness. And one of the strange things that the family had a hard time recognizing is that, how can this person be so joyful? How can this person smile through all, and up to now, not one word of complaint? And one of the things that she said to me was, I want you. There is one song that I want to have played, and that is, mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. And when that is played, I just want the musical instrument to be playing that and just singing, recognizing that I am in a place of comfort and rest and peace in the arms of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so for us, we can have comfort and assurance because of what God has said in his word, and because we have no need to fear, and it has been eliminated because of the presence of Jesus Christ. Isolation and loneliness are eliminated because of God's enduring and sustaining presence. He makes all the difference in the world when he's a part of our lives. And so we ask ourselves again, what time is it exactly? What time is it? Not just a time to mourn, and a time to be comforted, and a time to remember. It is a time of grieving. It is a time that we are able to just bear our souls before the presence of the one who gave us life. It is a time that we are being called to trust God. Solomon provides the thesis for this poem right from the very beginning. Everything has its time. Everything has its place. And this statement builds strongly on the thought that a wise person knows when to do or say something. This poem is merely observing the rhythm and the flow of life. People are healed and people are killed. People are living and people are dying. That's the reality of our world. William Barrick effectively sums up the message of this poem, which continues through from verse 9 through 22 of chapter 3 of Ecclesiastes, which he addresses. What is the point of this description of time-oriented events? It is that nothing happens haphazardly. Nothing happens by chance. No, fate governs the things that happen in the lives of God's people. God is in control. He is our Alpha and Omega. Never mind those who think that they are in control. We know that there is still a bigger God above everything else that is unveiling or being unveiled, before us. And that's our God who controls everything. The seasons of our lives are in the hands of Almighty God. The only thing that we know is what is happening right now. We don't know about tomorrow or the day after tomorrow. We only know about today. And so we trust the one who gave us life and called us from our mother's wombs and entrusted us into their care, and who has journeyed with us through the seasons of our lives to do far more exceedingly abundantly than we can ever ask or ever imagine. He is the one who holds our lives and who holds our tomorrows in his hands. Who knew on that day that this is what was going to happen? How could Uncle Barry possibly know? Made his usual visit, they made together for treatment. Who knew that he would have returned home without his beloved Wendy? Nobody knew. And we are not aware of what will happen for our tomorrow. But we give God thanks that he holds our tomorrows in the palm of his hands. And like Sister Wendy, who recognized the author and the finisher and the perfecter of her faith, so we are called to recognize our times and seasons and to entrust them into the best hands ever, who will take care. And so that beautiful song, Time, Like an Ever-Rolling Stream, bears all its sons, its daughters away. They fly forgotten as a dream dies at the open day. We give God thanks for her life. We give God thanks for the trail and the legacy that she has left behind. When I think of her, I think of a stream that meanders, and in the various places that it goes, it touches the lives of the individuals that she has come into contact with, that she has left a mark upon. Because you know, when the stream passes through and it meanders, the area becomes wet, and when you look, there are crops that will grow. And that's how her life is reflected in the growth in the many hundreds of persons whose lives she has touched, whether it was in Guyana, in Belize, or in Jamaica. And we think of the legacy of our own lives. What is it that we are going to be leaving behind? And what season are we living in? A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to gather, or a time to scatter. A time to build. Where exactly do we find ourselves, and what season exactly are we living in? May God grant us the strength of his grace, even as we celebrate her life, to ensure that it is well with our souls. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As we continue to reflect on the word that was just brought by Bishop Christine, I now invite you all to please stand as we affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. As we say together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite at this time the family to please sit, and the rest of us remain standing as we continue to support the family of Wendy Pamela Litchmore. And I want to urge us that even though we are out today in our numbers, our support mustn't end today. But even as the days continue ahead, those are the days when I believe the family will need our support through our prayers. So continue to hold them up before Almighty God. Let us pray. And so, Father in heaven, as we come before you this day, we come, Lord, recognizing that you are a loving, caring, and compassionate God, and that you are a God who never fails. And so even at this time, O God, we know that you draw close to this family and that you will support them every moment of every day. And so we pray, O God, that you will not only hold them but touch them individually and collectively, that you will support them, you will strengthen them, you will guide them, and that in turn they will look to you, the author and the finisher of their faith, and give you thanks. And so, Lord, surround them now with your very presence and with your love. And we pray, O God, that you will even dispatch angels, Lord, to hover around them as they go from day to day. So bless them, guide them, protect them, and lead them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
The Lord be with you. After the prayer of thanksgiving, the choir will sing. And after the choir has sung, I'll invite us all to stand for the commendation, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We bless you. We bless your name for the life of her whom we lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing her life has brought to others, for her service to her generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of her life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed her all the days of her life, that now the trials of this world are over and the death itself is past. Receive her into your perfect kingdom and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The combined choir. So we stand for the commendation. Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our sister, Wendy Pamela, to your eternal mercy and wisdom. Rest eternal grant unto her, and let perpetual light shine upon her. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Please be seated.
My sisters and brothers, I recall that there are significant moments in our lives when, in God's providential design, He allows our path to cross with persons whose mutual influences have been simply life-transforming. Such has been the experience between Wendy and I for over 30 years. Influencing and transforming was our constant theme until death separated us on 15 June 2023. And even on that eventful day, we were influencing and transforming when we were at the hospital and there was an emergency, so she was not able to see the person who was doing the blood test. So I still had the card in my pocket. And after that emergency subsided, she said to me, "Do you still have that card?" I said, "Yes." "But why you keep it in your pocket?" So I rushed and handed over the card and had to remind her that she was not very well, so she could ought to take it a little easier. And so, my friends, I stand here to acknowledge and to affirm again with confidence the goodness of God. Our God has been faithful, faithful in all His promises, bountiful in all His gifts, and our God has been genuine in all His relationships. And to acknowledge the invaluable contributions of all persons climaxing to this day, and certainly beyond this day, is indeed an impossible task. However, I will make a valiant attempt in sharing with us from my own perspective. So I acknowledge that for the past 10 years in particular, we experienced the professionalism and compassion of medical staff of the Kingston Public Hospital, University Hospital, diagnostic centers, pharmacists, and other medical institutions and personnel. The closing hours in particular will never be forgotten at the Kingston Public Hospital, in particular, the Accident and Emergency Department and Ward 3B. The staff rallied with sensitivity, compassion, dignity, and professionalism. A debt of gratitude is still owed to that specialist who gave medical oversight, guidance, advice, encouragement for the past 10 years. We acknowledge the contribution of the extended family on both sides, the cooperation, empathy, sympathy, and support have been simply amazing. However, I'm obligated to mention my own mother of 98 years, my brother and sister, my sisters and brothers who were instantly adopted into one family since our sacred union of 16 February 1991. Members of the extended family who have traveled from afar today to render emotional and physical support, your efforts are commendable. Relatives and friends from my home districts of Almond Hill and Rock Hall and the Western St. Andrew Circuit, thank you most sincerely. I acknowledge the invaluable support of ministerial colleagues here in the Providence Circuit, the Jamaica District, the Connection, and the wider ecumenical circles. And many are present here today. Numerous friends often take for granted. You have simply rekindled the cords of love and sense of belonging. Profound acknowledgement and gratitude to our Connectional President, Bishop Reverend Everett Galbraith, who is present here today. Your care and colleagueship have remained consistent for the past 40 years. Our own district bishop, the Reverend Christine Gooden-Bengouche, my neighbor and sister, who immediately assumed responsibilities for the manse and for my general well-being since the moment of 15 June 2023. To the Guyana district, where I served for 21 years, and the members of the circuits in which we have labored since returning to Jamaica in September 2020. You have rallied with love and devotion. And present here today are our friends from the Beechamville and Benson, Manchester, and of course the Providence circuits. Your telephone calls, messages, and assurance of prayerful support and other living testimonies are indeed acknowledged. Your presence here today is indeed a living testimony to the fact that God is a God of providence who brings his people together at the time appointed. And here at Providence Congregation, you have exceeded so many expectations through your generous offerings as members, stewards, musicians, choristers, digital and multimedia team members. Special thanks to our sister Beulah McCain, who creatively designed the order of worship as well as the bookmarker, to the individuals who continue to visit the manse and to provide for the refrigerator, and for the shelves, for the utility areas, and for persons who provide transportation from time to time. To the Resources and Development Committee, who organized and sponsored the repast for today, and for members and friends who have ensured my travel to Guyana and return will be free from undue anxiety. To members and friends near and far, who have provided financial support in many ways, I thank you on behalf of my family here very sincerely. And to Babsy, my cousin Babsy, she's a spear cousin, and her father Timmy, and they have taken up residence at the manse, and they have really ensured that there is stability and there is continuity. So thank you very much, Timmy. Thank you very much, Babsy. I want to thank Brother Edgar Moore of the funeral home and to acknowledge his contribution because he accommodated our family with such understanding, professionalism, and dignity. I thank you most sincerely, Mr. Moore. And today I want to advertise here, my friends, if you need a funeral home, to operate with dignity, professionalism, and punctuality, please consult the telephone number at the back of your orders of service. And although treading carefully, cautiously, and calculatedly, I'm sure that someone who has made some contribution has been inadvertently omitted. I seek your forgiveness, and so reinforce expressions of appreciation as inscribed on your orders of worship. And I will reread what is there. We express our sincere and heartfelt appreciation to you for extending much love, support, and kindness to our family. Your calls, prayers, visits, and assistance have helped to comfort and to sustain us. She will be greatly missed and fondly remembered. And even though I was very careful and I still think that I've forgotten one person, that person is myself. The journey continues to another critical phase to Guyana, the land of Wendy's birth. A memorial service of thanksgiving will be held at the Trinity Methodist Church, Georgetown, on August 3. You will note in your orders that it is August 4, but in fact it is August 3. And thereafter, her mortal remains will be laid to rest in the St. Mary's Presbyterian Church Cemetery, Mahaika, East Coast, Demerara. We crave your continual prayerful support. And please join us, the family, for a period of fellowship and modest repast in the upper hall at the close of the worship service. Thank you most sincerely for being here today. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And so we sing our closing hymn at this time of celebration, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Fix it up.
standing. You may remain standing for these instructions. After the benediction is pronounced by our connectional bishop, Bishop Galbraith, the Women's League are going to form a guard of honor. So they will position themselves to form a guard of honor. And of course, the combined choir will ask you to position yourselves to leave this chapel. The pallbearers will be invited to come to the front so that the casket may follow those of us who have been officiating. And that done, music only of the recessional hymn. And of course, you've had an invitation to go to the upper hall to be refreshed. So the committal. We know that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And since our sister Wendy Pamela has departed out of this life, and Almighty God in his mercy has taken her to himself, we therefore commit her body to leave the shores of Jamaica, to be interred in the land of Guyana, where the ground will receive and she be blended there in the land of her birth, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
that he gave.